Hi there, I'm Professor Dr. Afzalunnesa Bintul Lutfar, Head of the Department of Microbiology at the Women's Medical College. Assalamu alaikum to you all and thank you for coming to my session. Today we are going to discuss about Clostridium botulinum, one of the neurotoxin producer. So let's begin with the neurotoxins. Talking of neurotoxin, what are the neurotoxins and what are the bacteria that produces neurotoxins? Number one. Number one, Clostridium tetani. You know all that. Yes, video of thakbe. Number two, Clostridium botulinum. And surprisingly, number three, Shigella. You know, Shigella produces toxin which acts in three mechanisms. First, it causes watery diarrhea, then bacillary, you know, bloody dysentery, and then also it may act as neurotoxin because Shigella toxin 2, type 2, can act as neurotoxin. All right. So, we are today going to discuss about Clostridium botulinum and its toxin. You know, Clostridium botulinum is an anaerobic gram-positive bacilli and causes a potent, very deadly poison, and that may cause death from the botulism food poisoning. Let me give you a clinical picture or a problem. Like a person came to a town and had his dinner with a tuna sandwich. So, and the tuna was not freshly prepared, so he had to take a tin tuna sandwich and then he went to sleep. Next day in the morning, people found him dead. What can be the reason of his dying? So today, I think when we finish our discussion today, you will be able to understand why the patient fell dead and how it happened, okay? So, talking of Clostridium botulinum, which causes botulism, it is the toxin that leads to the paralytic disease, and this potent protein neurotoxin is highly potent because a very minimum amount of it can cause nerve tissue, damage in the nerve. So, it is what is the main features that may occur in botulism? The botulism is characterized by symmetrical descending and flaccid type of paralysis of motor and autonomic nerves, usually begin with the cranial nerves. So I'm going to the neurotoxin, how this neurotoxin acts on your nerves. So you see, let me draw you this picture and then compare it, this one with other neurotoxin, you will be able to understand. See, if this is the nerve ending, you know, within the nerve ending there will be vesicles containing acetylcholine, right? This is the neuromuscular junction, say this is the muscle fiber, muscle fiber, and the acetylcholine will be released in the neuromuscular junction. Usually, there are receptors on which the acetylcholine acts and causes stimulus to the nerve fiber, muscle fiber, to contract, and that is how the muscle contraction and relaxation alternately occurs to give us a certain motor function. But what happens is, suppose, you know, I was talking about toxin, you should also remember that Clostridium botulinum toxin may be released previously in the food, and the food, you know, food may contain this toxin, meaning these toxins are preformed toxin that is ingested by the people, and when the toxin enters into the body, since it has already been there within the food, it acts immediately, right? So the toxin here will act. So maybe if you see, this is the toxin. So how the toxins act on the nerve, at the nerve ending, you know, I think the later theory is more appropriate, may also happen that these prevents the acetylcholine release from the nerve ending. So if the acetylcholine cannot release from the nerve ending, the acetylcholine is no more there in the neuromuscular junction to act on the receptor either. So this is how it acts, and now how this botulinum toxin can enter in our body, how the mode of transmission of the toxin occurs, you know. But before that, let me explain to you the difference between autoimmune disease like myasthenia gravis, which you have must have gone through during your type 2 hypersensitivity reaction, which because it is a prototype example of type 2 hypersensitivity reaction, right? So in myasthenia gravis, there also they cause also flaccid type of paralysis. So what is the difference between myasthenia gravis and between Clostridium botulinum? So in myasthenia gravis, you know, let me draw in here. In myasthenia gravis, there, since it is autoimmune disease, some people may produce antibody against acetylcholine receptor. So in myasthenia gravis, people will have antibody in their blood. So antibody of what? Antibody against acetylcholine receptor. So that and type of facet paralysis, you know, let me draw the receptor. So say this, these are the receptor at the motor end plate, receptor for acetylcholine, okay, and the vesicles containing acetylcholine. So these acetylcholine have to bind, usually they bind here and act on the muscle giving contraction. Okay, so what happens when there is already lot of antibody against acetylcholine receptor, this antibody will bind here, okay, bind here, this antibody will bind here, since this is a autoantibody, so they will come bind the receptor here. So the receptor is not free for the acetylcholine to act on it or to give any impulse for the muscular contraction. So what happens is same type of flaccid paralysis occur. So the difference is in Clostridium botulinum, the toxin binds at the nerve ending. Again, I have to repeat, you may be confused. So the acetylcholine is not released in case of Clostridium botulinum, because the toxin prevents the release of acetylcholine from the nerve ending at the junction. And in case of autoimmune diseases or myasthenia gravis, the antibody against acetylcholine will bind to the acetylcholine receptor, so that acetylcholine will be released but cannot act on the receptor, cannot bind to the receptor, cannot act on the muscular motor end plate, so there will be no contraction. The similar flaccid type of paralysis occurs in both the cases. So you have to differentiate by, you know, investigation. I have talked about it details in myasthenia gravis, or I think in autoimmune disease. So I will not go into that, how you will differentiate that, but you must know the difference in the mechanism of action so that you know it. Now let me let me remind you how Clostridium tetani acts, because you know Clostridium tetani causes spastic type of paralysis. And how is that? Same nerve ending. If I have to show you here, you know, Clostridium tetani on the other hand causes, there will be release of acetylcholine in Clostridium tetani here, okay, release of acetylcholine here, acetylcholine is there, but Clostridium tetani toxin or tetanospasmin will bind here, acting at the montorin plate, inhibits release of inhibitory neurotransmitter. So it inhibits, let me draw with a different, it inhibits release of inhibitory neurotransmitter. So there will be no inhibitory neurotransmitter to oppose the action of acetylcholine, because the toxin binds here, inhibiting the release. So toxin binds here, no inhibitory neurotransmitter release, acetylcholine sustained action on the receptor. So there will be sustained unopposed action of Clostridium tetani toxin or tetanospasmin at the montorin plate, leading to the continuous contraction and spastic type of contraction to the person. So this is how three different type of paralysis may occur in the body, two with neurotoxin and one as a autoimmune disease, right? So talking of botulism, how botulism occurs? It may occur by introduction along with the food as a preformed toxin. It may be iatrogenic, or it may be also a cause of inhalation botulism. Then, you know, there can be wound botulism by iatrogenic introduction through injection at the wound site. So there can be a wound in botulism, and very importantly, there can be infant botulism. So we'll be discussing now the how a botulism patient will present with, what the botulism patient will present to you. Since they starts from the central nervous system, and usually it is symmetrical, you know. So the patient may come with ptosis or paralysis of the eyelid muscle, causing ptosis or paresis, paralysis involving extraocular eyelid. Then dry mucous membrane, dry mouth, dry throat. Patient's pupil can be fixed or dilated. Ataxia can occur. Patient may have, you know, nystagmus, involuntary movement, or patient may have astigmatism. Patient will not be able to smile, or even smile, asymmetrical smile. You will find that something is wrong with his, you know, muscle, facial muscles. Patient will be unable to drink anything. There will be drooling, unable to drink or whistle. So these are the symptoms patient usually come up with. And what happens in case of infant botulism? In case of infant botulism, it may occur in either of the two ways, you know. The preformed toxin may be given to the infant through infant feed, you know. They are available, mainly it is easily available for commercially or working mother. Infant food is available in Western countries, so it can happen that food may contain this botulinum toxin, or it may go through the honey. You know, honey can, during the derivement of honey from the, it may become contaminated with organism or spore, anyone. So when the baby is given honey, if it is an organism infection, the organism will bind to the receptor, to the baby. Actually, baby in neonate, they have plenty free receptors, because as you grow by, you become exposed to many organism, and they take the receptors of your gut. So the gut is usually remain free in case of infant, so they become occupied with the Clostridium botulinum organism. Slowly they can produce toxin. It is slow progressing disease, and if it is due to the spore, it may germinate within the gut, you know. Usually in the gut is an anaerobic environment. It may germinate and then produce toxin. So infant botulism is a kind of slow growing disease if it is due to the honey or the by taking the spore or bacteria. There can be three kinds of botulism. foodborne botulism, wound botulism and infant botulism. You know, foodborne botulism is a kind of food poisoning, the only food poisoning where you do not have diarrhea or vomiting, rather you have, you know, flaccid type of paralysis. I've already told you the sign symptom. And the wound botulism, which is usually iatrogenic, and infant botulism, I told you how it happens. So what happens in the food, they have a specific disease named floppy baby syndrome. So this floppy baby syndrome means the patient will, infant will have hypotonia, decreasing muscle tone gradually, okay. So the bad news we have gone through already, but there is one good news in case of Clostridium botulinum toxin, that is, it can be utilized as a treatment, you know. So these flaccid type of paralysis caused by the neurotoxin can be utilized in the neurological conditions like spasmodic torticollis, hyperhidrosis, bladder, overactive bladder problem, then strabismus, blepharospasm. To these diseases, this toxin is becoming very promising to treat on. And the last but not the least, the good news is for us, the girls, that this toxin is being utilized as Botox by the beautician to prevent the wrinkles, to prevent your, to look good and young, you know. So with this note, I would like to finish today. So see you again next class, in the next class. Stay safe and healthy. Goodbye and Allah Hafiz.